that when Jesus Christ said it is finished, the Lord Jesus Christ has completed the work of redemption for us. There's nothing anymore to do. He has finished the work. He has finished everything for you and me. He does not have to return to finish his suffering. If he returns one day and he will come back one day, he will come back to take us home. He's not coming back to finish something he did not finish. He is coming back to take us home. Lift up your heads, for your redemption draweth nigh, the Bible says. Perhaps I don't have any more time to be able to give you the chronology of the death of the Lord Jesus Christ until he rose again from the grave. But may I say this to you, as I always say every year when we come together, the Lord Jesus Christ did not die on a Friday. That is what religion is telling you. The Lord Jesus Christ died on Wednesday afternoon. All right? And he rose again on Saturday afternoon before Sunday. Now, in the Jews, Sunday is 6 o'clock in the evening. So therefore, to us, 6 o'clock of Saturday to the Jews is 6 o'clock Sunday. Okay? Now, we have to be very, very passionate with that, because I believe that when the Bible says that Christ was in the midst of the earth 3 days and three nights, that's exactly what it should be. All right? Exactly what it should be. 24 hours. Today, from 1 o'clock in the afternoon. Is that 1 o'clock in the afternoon you started? From 1 o'clock in the afternoon, we have preachers here that spoke of the seven sayings of the Lord on the cross. The first saying was in the book of Luke 23 and verse number 43, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." The second saying says, "Truly, I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise." The third saying in the book of John chapter 19, verses 26-27, it says, "Woman, this is your son. This is your mother." The fourth saying, written in the book of Matthew chapter 27 and Mark chapter 15, my God, why have you forsaken me?" The fifth saying in John 19, 28, it says, "I thirst." The sixth saying in John 19, 30, "It is finished." And the seventh saying in Luke 23, verse 46, "Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit." The seven sayings that Jesus spoke on the cross during his last hours on earth exhibited his perfection as the Word made flesh. In the book of John chapter 1 and verse number 14, the Bible says, "And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth." And that is the Lord Jesus Christ. So tonight, let me just look into the seven sayings and be able just to explain to you briefly what the seven sayings on the cross are. First of all, we have the first saying in the book of Luke chapter 23 and verse number 34, where it says, "Then said Jesus, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And they parted his raiment and cast lots." The Roman soldiers gambled on the clothes of the Lord Jesus Christ. You see? But then, what does the statement tell us? The Lord Jesus Christ spoke forgiveness to those who nailed him to the cross. Even to those who nailed Christ to the cross, the Lord Jesus Christ spoke forgiveness. signifying that he is the great intercessor and that there is forgiveness of sins through him alone. It means that only Jesus Christ can forgive sins. Not the priest, not the pastor, not any man, not any religious leader, but the Lord Jesus Christ alone. In 1 John 1, 7, it says, but if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanseth us from all sin. In verse number 9, it says, if we confess our sins, he, or Jesus Christ, is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. We have been forgiven. Past, present, future, we have been forgiven. The second saying says, Luke 23, verse 43 tells us, and Jesus said unto him, verily I say unto thee, today shalt thou be with me in paradise. He was talking to the thief on the cross, isn't it? There were two thieves that were nailed to the cross with Jesus Christ. Oh. One thief says, well, if you are truly the Messiah, why don't you save yourself and then, of course, save us also? You know? Sabi niya, all right? We have find here in the book of Luke chapter 23. Luke chapter 23. And the other thief said, don't you fear God? In verse number 40, don't you fear God? Saying, we are in the same condemnation. But this man referring to Jesus, had not done anything wrong. He had not done anything wrong. Do you know why? He was perfect. He was blameless. He was holy. Why would he die on the cross? He died on the cross for us. He did not die on the cross for himself. He died on the cross for us. Now in doctrine, we call it the substitutionary sacrifice of Jesus Christ. The atonement. You see? All right. And then the thief said, Lord, remember me when thou comest into thy kingdom. Now you would not find the word repentance. You don't find the word confession. You do not find the word I receive into my heart as my Savior. But when you look at the words that he said, there was repentance. You look at the words that he said, there was confession. You look at the words that he said, there was faith. He put his faith upon Jesus Christ. He believed that only the Lord Jesus Christ can what? Can bring him to heaven. He knew that the Lord Jesus Christ will only die and rose again from the grave. He believed that. That's why he said, Lord, remember me when thou comest into thy kingdom. And Jesus said unto him, verily I say unto thee, today shalt thou be with me in paradise. The Lord Jesus Christ spoke salvation to the penitent thief. And Jesus promises the same assurance today in our own hearts and lives. The third saying, in John chapter 19, verses 26 to 27, it says, when Jesus therefore saw his mother and the disciple, which is John the Beloved, standing by whom he loved, he said unto his mother, woman, behold thy son. Then saith he to the disciple, behold thy mother. And from that hour, that disciple took her unto his own home. What would be the appropriate meaning for this? The Lord Jesus Christ spoke love and devotion to and for his mother. he did not declare that his mother is the mother of God, isn't it? He did not even say that his mother is the queen of heaven. He just spoke love to his mother, and he said, woman. He did not even call his mother, mother. He said, woman. Do you know why? Because in reality, the Son of God does not have any mother at all. Mary was his mother only in the flesh. Mary was just used by God in order for Jesus Christ will be born in the flesh. See? Now, of course, we believe in the virgin birth of the Lord Jesus Christ. He was born of a virgin. He was not born with a man. He was born of the virgin. And then you know what he told the disciple? He told John, John, take care of my mother. He charged John to take care of her. He said, John, behold thy mother. It means, John, I'm going away. I'm going to die. I'm charging you, make her your mother. You see? And the Bible says, and from that hour, that disciple took her unto his own home. Mary was left to John's keeping. It does not in any way mean or suggest mediatorship through Mary. Because there's only one mediator between God and man, and that man is Christ Jesus. Amen? Yes. All the religion will tell you that Mary is the mediatrix. The Bible says there's only one mediator between God and man, and that is the Lord Jesus Christ. The fourth saying is in the book of Matthew chapter 27 in verse number 46, where it says, and about the ninth hour, Jesus cried with a loud voice saying, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, that is to say, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? He cried with a loud voice in the ninth hour. The ninth hour, which is a Jewish time, in our time would be 3 o'clock in the afternoon. The sixth hour is a time in which you divide the hour by 12. Therefore, when you speak of 6 o'clock in the morning, to us, that is the first hour. And therefore, when you speak of the sixth hour, it might either be 9 o'clock in the morning or 11 o'clock in the morning. That was the sixth hour. It was hot. It was summertime when the Lord Jesus Christ died. And of course, at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, that is the hottest part of the year. Am I right? 3 o'clock. And the Bible says, at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, the Lord Jesus Christ cried with a loud voice. And you would notice he said with a loud voice. It means when Christ was on the cross, he was not weak. He was still strong. You know, when religion has portrayed the Lord Jesus on the cross to be a very thin person with his ribs coming out and everything like this, as if that he's just so weak. No, our Lord is strong. See, he cried with a loud voice. Now, if you, for example, a nail on the cross, you see, with the weight of your body only being carried by those nails, and you have been beaten so much when you're walking down the road to Calvary carrying your cross, and they thrust a spear in your side, I don't think you would be strong enough to speak this. Am I right? But the Lord Jesus Christ, despite the fact that he was already beaten and crushed, all right, and slapped so many times, and his beard was plucked out. And the Roman soldiers put a crown of thorns on his head. And they didn't just put the crown of thorns. They actually pushed that crown of thorns in Christ's head. I do not know if you have read the scientific medical explanation of the death of the Lord Jesus Christ. It was actually traumatic for me even to think about that. I didn't realize that the Lord Jesus Christ suffered so much for me. And what am I doing? Huh? Do you realize how much Christ suffered for you? And what are you doing? You think we can still be proud of ourselves? You think we can just give time to the Lord and say, Lord, look, I'm giving time to you. What are we doing? And so many times, I would look at many believers of Jesus Christ and I would even think that, the Lord Jesus Christ owes us a lot of things. Does he owe anything from us? No. We owe everything to him. Now you look at Jesus Christ on the cross. When I was quite young and still strong in this pulpit, I would demonstrate the death of Christ. You know, I cannot do it anymore because I'm kind of old, isn't it? I have to walk with a cane. I'm in pain with arthritis and everything like this. And I have to sit for a while so that I would not have pain in my spinal. But when I was young, I was so passionate in even describing the death of Jesus Christ on the cross so that every member would realize he suffered much for you. And so many times we serve him, we give our offerings, and we think that God owes us something. I don't care if you live five lives, you can still pay what Jesus Christ has done for you. Do you realize that? Do you realize that? That's how God loved us. Do you think that anybody among your loved ones, your children or your parents would do that to you? I was watching a movie at Netflix, and to me, it's such a, I don't care if you're grown up. Even if you're grown up, you have no right to disrespect your parents. Do you realize that? Do you realize that? And that's the kind of society we're living in today. You only obey your parents when you were young. You only respect your parents when you were young and still in the control of your parents because you get your money from them and you study and you get the allowance from them. But when you're grown up, you begin to think you have the right to shout and yell at your parents. You have the right to say no. You have the right to tell your parents, behave. I don't care how old you are. You should still respect your parents. How about Christ? How do we respect Christ? How do we obey the Lord Jesus Christ? Do you think that we could be able just to explain to you the seven things on the cross? And that being able to realize who we are and what Jesus Christ did for us. He's not demanding 24 hours from you, is he? He's not demanding all of your income, is he? No. He's just telling you to obey and do what is right, isn't it? And we cannot even do it. Huh? We cannot even do it. You know, I told my son when he was still in the world, you cannot live in my house because I'm not going to allow even my own son to live in my house when he's making a mockery of my God. Because to me, my God is more precious than anyone else. Do you realize that? So what kind of society we're living in now? You know, I was in the States for a couple of weeks because I had a high-level conference in Washington, D.C. with some senators and congressmen. We were discussing things about human rights. Come to think of it, human rights. In reality, a lot of people think it's human rights, but it's human wrong. It's not human rights. To be gay is not human rights, it's human wrong. To smoke drug is not human rights, it's human wrong. And we don't even realize that now. Do you realize that there are some countries in Europe where they have made it a law that even an adult person can have sex with young children? The pedophiles now can do what they want to do? You realize that in Vancouver, Canada, that there is a law that you could be able to have sex with animals? Is that human rights? It's human wrong, isn't it? I do not know why I was elected in Congress to be the chairman of the Committee on Human Rights. And when I speak of human rights, I only speak of human rights according to what the Bible says. Now, I'm not going to be discriminatory on people, no. I don't care what your gender might be, I don't care what you do. The Bible says that love must prevail. But that love does not mean I should compromise. And that love does not mean that I should be able to accept your lifestyle when it is sinful, isn't it? We realize how that the Lord Jesus Christ told his Father, my God, why hast thou forsaken? Do you know why God, the Father, has to forsake his Son? Because at that very moment, the Bible says that he was bearing our sins on the cross. The Bible says he was made sin for us that knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. He was made sin for us. When God the Father looked at his Son on the cross of Calvary, he was looking at him as a man that is sinful because of you and me. And God cannot look down on sin, isn't it? That's why Jesus had to cry out to God, "My God, my God, why hast thou forsaken me?" The Lord Jesus Christ spoke of severe anguish, such as this world has never known. Sin was laid on Christ. So God must turn away his face from the sin bearer. And Jesus Christ was our sin bearer. It pleased the Father to forsake his own Son for our sake. In Isaiah chapter 53 and verse number 11, it tells us, "He shall see of the travail of his soul, and what? And shall be satisfied." God shall see the travail and the sacrifice and the suffering of his own Son and shall be satisfied. Do you know why? Because he's doing it for you. He's doing it for me. And that is how God loved us. That's how God loved you. There are some people who say, "I will die for my faith." Oh, come on. You don't even live for your faith and you're going to die for your faith? Huh? You cannot even say what the Apostle Paul said before he was martyred. "I have finished my course. I have kept the faith." So many times, Christians just think of God to be something that will give them all the desires of their hearts. Am I right? Sacrifice, suffering should not be among Christians anymore at this time. What we expect God to do is to bless us. What we expect God to do is to give us everything we want. Listen. That's not the case, folks. Do you know what the Apostle Paul said in Galatians 2:20? "I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Yet not I, but Christ liveth in me, and the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me." You've got to realize Apostle Paul, before he got saved, was a lawyer, isn't it? He was a member of the Sanhedrin court. He was a bureaucrat in the nation of Israel. You think that any lawyer, even those times, are poor? No. But you know what he said? "Everything that is gained of me, I count it but what? Dung." Do you know what dung is? Waste. "Anything that is gained of me, I count it but waste." That what? "That I may win Christ." But that is no longer true to many, 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 many Christians today in this world. I want to use the word Christian because almost everyone wants to call himself a Christian. What happened to sacrifice and suffering? We always want convenience, always want comfort, and you begin to complain when there's no comfort. You begin to complain when there's no convenience. Did you ever hear the Lord complaining when he was suffering? In the book of Isaiah chapter 53, the Bible says he did not open his mouth. Do you realize that? When he was being slapped, when his beard is being plucked off, when they put a crown of thorns upon his head, when they begin to beat him at the back, he did not open his mouth. But us, little pain, we complain. Little thing that we do not have, we complain. And you say you love God. The fifth saying tells us in John 19, verse number 28. After this, Jesus, knowing that all things were now accomplished, that the scriptures might be fulfilled, said, I thirst. The Lord Jesus Christ spoke of his physical suffering. When some stupid theologians would tell you that his suffering was superficial, you know? I was talking to some pastors in the States one day, and many of them have doctorate degrees. Well, their doctorate degrees are not even earned. I earned my doctorate degree. You know, I joke on them. I told them, you know what? You have your doctorate degree on you so you can doctor the Word of God, huh? Huh? You can change the translation. You could be able to modernize it in order to, you know, accommodate the modern man and everything like this. The sufferings of Christ was not superficial. It was true. The Lord did not use his power when he suffered for us. In fact, he told Peter when he cut off the ear of a certain person, am I right? Peter was actually, you know, focusing his sword in the middle of his head. But, you know, he was able to evade that, and only the ear was hit. Do you know what the Lord Jesus Christ said? He said, you know what, Peter? I can order 10 legions of angels right now to deliver me. And they will. He did not use even a small iota of power so that he will not be able to bear the pain. I thirst tells us that the Lord Jesus Christ spoke of his physical suffering on the cross. He suffered as a man to the fullest extent. He felt those nails that was put upon him on his hands. He felt every pain that was given to him for me, for you. The sixth saying says in the book of John, chapter 19 and verse number 30, it says, when Jesus therefore had received the vinegar, he said, it is finished. And he bowed his head and gave up the ghost. What's the meaning of this? The Lord Jesus Christ spoke the greatest and strongest word ever uttered. Tetelestai. In the Greek, it is finished. Do you know what that means? Again, let me tell you of a story. I was actually watching the Siete Palabras, so they call it, isn't it, on television, when the priest was explaining what the word "it is finished" mean. You know what he said? He said, the Lord Jesus Christ said, it is finished. You know what is finished? It's over. He died. That's it. Can you imagine a priest who spent 10 years in the seminary could just say that thing? Huh? Why? He's ignorant of the Word of God. He did not experience the saving grace of Jesus Christ. He does not have the Holy Spirit in him. Because if he has, he will say that when Jesus Christ said, it is finished, the Lord Jesus Christ has completed the work of redemption for us. There's nothing anymore to do. He has finished the work. He has finished everything for you and me. He does not have to return to finish his suffering. If he returns one day and he will come back one day, he will come back to take us home. He's not coming back to finish something he did not finish. He is coming back to take us home. Lift up your heads, for your redemption draw it nigh, the Bible says. It is finished. Then the seventh saying on the cross in Luke chapter 23 and verse number 46 tells us, and when Jesus had cried with a loud voice, he said, Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit. And having thus said thus, he gave up the ghost. The Lord Jesus Christ spoke of words of contentment. He spoke of peace in his heart. He spoke knowing that he had finished his work on earth and had completely satisfied the Heavenly Father. Have you read the prayer of Jesus Christ in the book of John chapter 17? Huh? Have you read that? Huh? Read it. Read John chapter 17. That's the prayer of Jesus Christ. You know what he said there? He said, Lord, let this cup pass from me. Do you know the meaning of that? Lord, please don't make me suffer. Lord, let this cup of suffering pass from me. But you know what he said? Nevertheless, thy will be done. I will be done. He literally dismissed his spirit and laid down his life. I heard of a pastor that says that the Lord Jesus Christ committed suicide. he should get out of the ministry and just be a salesman selling crosses in the street. In John chapter 10, verse number 15, as the Father knoweth me, even so know I the Father, and I what? And I lay down my life for the sheep. He was not even forced to lay down his life. He laid down his own life for us. Let me give you the reasons why I believe this to be the greatest words ever spoken. The reasons why these words that I said tonight are the greatest words ever spoken, because first of all, the words were spoken by the greatest person who ever lived. This was the greatest words because it was spoken by the greatest person who ever lived. And secondly, the words made known the greatest announcement ever proclaimed. The words made known the greatest announcement ever proclaimed. Jesus paid it all. John 17, verses number 3 and 4 tells us, and this is life eternal, that they might know thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom thou hast sent. I have glorified thee on earth. I have finished the work which thou gavest me to do. In 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse number 30, it tells us, but of him are ye in Christ Jesus, who of God is made unto us four things: wisdom, righteousness, sanctification, and redemption. The words were spoken by the greatest person who ever lived. The words were made known, the greatest announcement ever proclaimed. And thirdly, the words concerned the greatest number of people, reaching every mortal since the time of Adam. I believe this, folks. I believe that before Jesus Christ would come, every person on this earth would have heard the gospel. There was a question last night by a young person. And he said, Pastor, how about those living in the mountains? They have not heard the gospel. How about them? What will happen to them? I said, listen, they will hear the gospel. It will take time. They will hear the gospel. And I said, are you concerned about them hearing the gospel? Yes, I am. Give your life to the Lord. So I can send you over there. They may hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. Amen? He was quiet. He did not give his life to God. Yet he was concerned about tribal people hearing the gospel. You're concerned about that, you're questioning it, why don't you go there and preach the gospel to them? Do you know how many churches we have in the Mangyan, among the Mangyan people in Mindoro? With Pastor Lito Fadrikela establishing those churches. We even have about 6 Mangyan pastors. Those are tribal people. We're reaching the Mangyans. Do you realize that? I guess you don't even know who the Mangyans are. We're reaching the Igorot and the Ifugaos and the Cordillera. How many MBBE ministers do we have in the whole of the Cordillera that you don't even know about? We're reaching them. We're reaching those people who don't even know how to dress up like you and me. Who are you reaching? Who are you sharing? The world's concerned the greatest number of people reaching every mortal since the time of Adam. You know why I always would like to go to a, in our district, we give tupad. You know what tupad is? We give benefits for those who are working, but it's not enough for them. We give benefits to those who are not working, those who are PWDs and those who are drivers and those who are senior citizens. And whenever there's always a chance to be able to go there and meet those people, do you know what I do? I don't only tell them about what they're going to receive. I tell them of the greatest thing that they must have, receiving Christ in their lives. And how many thousands of those people in my district have heard the word of God to them? How many millions yet of our people in this country have heard the gospel? Question is, what are you doing about it? Huh? You are so busy doing your own work, you have no time even to get the gospel out. There is sure salvation for Jews and Gentiles alike. And do you realize how I pray for our politicians every day? Even if some of them heard the gospel already, the former mayor of Manila, Isko Moreno, came to know Christ here. He heard the gospel here. He received Jesus Christ here. He even prayed a sinner's prayer right in this pulpit. Do you realize that? I invited the present mayor, Hani Lacuna, to take my oath to her. For what reason? Taking my oath? No, that she might hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. The vice mayor of Manila, Yul Serbo, came here to visit me, and right there in the library, I won him to Jesus Christ. Whenever there is an opportunity, I open the word of God to them and tell them the precious good news of salvation. How about you? Huh? How about you? What was finished was not the life of the Savior, but His work of redemption afforded to man, and at the same time declaring, first of all, the end of Judaism. When Christ died on the cross, He was telling the Jews, this is the end of your religion, the end of all sacrifices. That's the reason why in the book of Hebrews, it says the priest would what? Would sacrifice daily the same sacrifices that cannot take away sin. When Christ died on the cross, He was telling the Jewish people, come on, that's the end of temple worship. Huh? That's why when the Lord Jesus Christ died, what happened? The veil of the temple was torn in halves from top to bottom. I always say that when you tear a curtain, you tear it from bottom to top, isn't it? But this time, that curtain, that thick curtain that is separating the holy place and the most holy place is what? Was torn from top to bottom. Telling us what? Telling us that anybody can go directly to God for their sins and not anymore go to any intermediary. The end of Judaism. The death of the Lord Jesus Christ is also the end of the old covenant. The end of the old covenant. You can read Hebrews chapter 9, verse 11 to 15. I have no more time to read that. You just write all the verses down and make it your own devotion. Thirdly, it's the end of sacrifices. Hebrews 10, 10 to 14. Fourthly, the beginning of a new life in Christ. Second Corinthians 5:17. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, is a new creature, all things have passed away, behold, all things are become new. Write them down. You're not just here to listen to me, you're going to forget it. You realize that? You don't have photographic minds. The beginning of a new life in Christ. What is another reason why the words spoken by Christ on the cross were the greatest words spoken? Fourthly, they announced the greatest victory ever won. The greatest victory ever won. The Jews thought, the chief priests thought, the scribes thought that when they nailed Christ on the cross, they have won and Christ has lost. They thought about that. They didn't realize that when Jesus died on the cross, it was victory. It was not a defeat. It was victory. Victory over sin, victory over the grave, victory over death. They announced the greatest victory ever won. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 55-57 tells us, O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Satan, the Lord's greatest enemy, tried to prevent the Lord Jesus from shedding his blood. Since the very beginning of the human race, you would notice the curse and the fall of man, the death of Abel, the promised seed, the union of the righteous people with a godly man, the death of the firstborn during Christ's birth, the temptation of the Lord Jesus Christ. Satan has always, since the beginning of man, tried to prevent the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. Do you realize that? But no. In all these things, Satan failed. Satan, you failed. Satan, you lost. God may allow you to take my life, but you're a loser, Satan. Can you say that to him? You are a loser. When I had those threats in my life, some people want to kill me. I said, I made a declaration. Listen, whether in life or in death, I am victorious because of Jesus Christ. You lose, Satan. You fail. And when Jesus Christ died on the cross, that was the thing that made Satan be defeated. Akala niyo ba he's defeated when Christ comes back? No. Doon lang sa cross, defeated na siya. It only means that no one can ever thwart or prostrate God's purposes. The Lord Jesus Christ died for us to live for Him, that He finished the work of salvation because we can neither finish it nor even start ourselves, and that Christ has done all these things because He loved us. You know John 3:16, isn't it? For God so loved the world, He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. You know Romans 5:8. But God commended His love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. The seven sayings on the cross. If there's anything that challenges me to serve God more, it's not you. It is Christ's death on the cross. I would praise God if you're serving Him, but you realize that some of our members are not serving God. They just want to sit down there and listen. But nothing is happening, isn't it? It's just like what I said among our young people last night. I said, but what are you writing down in your notes? Huh? You're writing down the outline of the preaching? Huh? How about writing down what your decision is? How about writing down what is your plan of action after this? So many times we just write down the message. But what will you do about it? Huh? Now you listen to the message right now and you listen good, isn't it? What are you going to do about it? Huh? What? Shall we stand? Before I call the visitors to come, I would like to talk to you people first that know Christ as your Savior. Is it just enough for you to know Christ as your Savior? Or you realize that you are saved to serve? Huh? Is it just enough for you to know Christ as your Savior? And you're so glad, you're so happy, you thank God, I thank the Lord, I'm saved. So what? You look at your life tonight and you search your own heart and see there. What are you doing? What are you doing for Jesus Christ? What are you doing for Christ? Look at your own life.